Keith, you are a renowned and award-making filmmaker, and we all know you well from the Metro Detroit area. Your most recent project is Detroit, the city of hot rods and muscle cars. So Motor Cities was proud to have been involved with this project with a grant. Can you tell us a bit about the film and the inspirations and the process and how you put it together?
You know, I'm 63 years old. I grew up during that era of the 60s and 70s, and hot rods and muscle cars were just part of everyday life. And I think that as a documentary storyteller, myself and my team decided we want to step back in our automotive history and tell the story of the hot rod and the muscle car and the impact Detroit had, the big three, as well as all the car makers and passionate muscle car aficionados and hot rods and how all these things came to be. But most importantly, the impact Detroit had on the world when it comes to hot rods and muscle cars. And so it was a fun, nostalgic step back in time for me. Personally, I just enjoyed, seeing and being able to sit in and a part of garages filled with, GTOs and Mustangs and, cars from that era. But it was a great learning lesson for me. I'm not a car guy. I mean, I was a car guy growing up, but not to the significance of some of the car guys that and gals we have in the film. So it was a great learning process for me. But I walk away with a whole new sense of appreciation and respect for those early individuals that would take a wrench and say, let me see if I can change this and make it a little faster. What if I can make it a little sharper looking? What if I cut this and did that to it? Showing that creative ingenuity was just really exciting for us.
So you included some huge names, some very well-known names around this circle. Someone like Tim Allen was a big part of the film. Can you talk about, his inclusion and how fun was it working with him?
When it came to really building the story, what we really wanted to do was make it a story about people. And so, being able to film with someone like Tim Allen, who raced up and down and lived on Woodward, and the impact the automotive world had on him, and he had on the world. But also people like Bob Lutz and Chip Foose and Danny Coker and the many other individuals that maybe are not a household name to everybody else, like Bill Collins, the father of GTO. But they allowed us to step back in time, if you will, through their stories, through their narrative, through their memories, and through their excitement. And I think that being able to spend time with a lot of them was just, that was really the highlight of the lot of fun of the whole project, for sure.
Great. So Diane, we know you from all around town, so many different auto events and activities you're involved with. Can you tell us about your current position? But then go back and tell us about your auto love story, because it started way before you got involved professionally. So tell us about your history.
So I'm employed with America's Automotive Trust, and we're based out of Tacoma, Washington. I joined the trust because of RPM Foundation, which is under our umbrella, and that stands for Restoration, Preservation, and Mentorship. So we can get young people involved in working on old cars, whether it's upholstery, the mechanics, body work, so that when I'm dead and gone, they can work on all my old cars.
So what about your love for auto, though? It started way, way back in the beginning. You share some of this in the film, but tell us about growing up and your love for cars.
Well, I grew up on a farm, and my dad taught me about cars when I was young. He said, we live 8 miles from town. If you want to learn to drive, you got to learn about the mechanics of the car. So if something happens on the way when you're driving, you can hopefully troubleshoot it yourself. That led into a career selling cars in 1979. I came to Southfield, Michigan, and started selling cars at Tamaroff Buick. So I sold Buick, Honda, Volkswagen, Yugo, DeLorean, Avanti, so a lot of nameplates. Sold cars for 7 years and became a manager for Tamaroff. So I was one of the first female salespersons in the Detroit area and for those name plates as well, without having either a father or a husband involved in a dealership.
Excellent. So we'll come back to that for sure. But so Diane's story is one of many, Keith, that was woven into the film and really exhibit the diversity of those involved in the auto hobby. So in the film, you'll see men and women, young and old, those dealing with disabilities. Tell us about some of those profiles of the sort of real people that the viewers will see and how you work with them.
Yeah, I mean, I had kind of a big aha moment when we were filming out in L.A. with Chip Foose, who's, you know, of course, one of the world's most recognized, well-known car designers, builders. And when we were filming with him, I had asked him, there are pictures of him and his dad around the shop, and I said, hey, what's up with your dad? Is he around? And he got real emotional about the fact that his dad had passed not too long ago. And so I asked him that on camera, and he really gets deeply emotional, and he gets choked up and has a hard time talking about it.
I was lucky and blessed to build a lot of cars with my father. But it wasn't the cars that were so important. It was the time that we spent together. My father was my best friend. I think about him all the time. Wish he was here.
And I realized then that the film was really about fathers and the impact fathers have had on their sons and daughters, and their love and passion and understanding of cars and mechanics. So we started to then gravitate the film towards that narrative. And then, you know, like with any documentary film, I always have this philosophy, the story we're going to tell is never the story we're going to tell. And that's really rang true. You know, I knew I wanted the story to be about as much about people as possible and less about cars, but really about people and the people behind the cars. We met Ruth and Gary. Ruth has stage 4 Parkinson's, and we met Ruth at a car show, and I was so inspired by this woman's desire to still cruise. And cruise is a big word in Detroit. You know, cruising is, you know, what people did up and down Woodward all through the 50s and 60s and still to this day. And I wanted to reach deeper into that story. So we ended up telling a story about Ruth and her Parkinson's and her husband's desire to make sure she can still be able to cruise and they still go cruising, even at her late stage Parkinson's. So it's a very emotional story beat. And then veterans, you know, we all understand the significance of our World War II veterans and Korean veterans, Vietnam veterans, but a lot of people don't understand when these veterans came back from the war, especially during World War II, they start tinkering with these 1932 Fords and they really created the hot rod in a lot of ways, especially the hot rod we're accustomed to seeing today. So I really wanted to tell the veteran story, and unfortunately a lot of our World War II veterans are no longer around, so we really gravitated to the Vietnam veteran and how when they came back from the war, it was a different time in our society. There was a lot of complicated views about Vietnam and the Vietnam veteran, the Vietnam War, and then just society in general. So we really told the Vietnam veteran story. I wanted to tell the Woodward Dream Cruise story, but I didn't want to tell it just flat, like the Woodward Dream Cruise. So we told the Woodward Dream Cruise story through the narrative and through the lives of three Vietnam veterans who reunite together to go for a cruise on Woodward. And so I think it was a far more impactful and emotional way to tell that story. And so, yeah, stories in the film are really what I think are the basis of what makes this film successful.
All right. Like I said, Diane, you're one of the featured stories in the film, along with many other female enthusiasts. And for years, it's been a stereotype about women just dragged into the hobby, or they're there just because of their dads or their sons or their brothers. But, you know, the film really talked about their individual passions and yours. So what do you say to those who still hold those conceptions about female roles in the auto hobby?
I wasn't dragged into it. I voluntarily came into it. I wanted a hot rod. So in 1983, my dad and I, and then some other people as well, helped me build my 1932 Ford, which this year, of course, it's celebrating, you know, it's 50th birthday with me. So, I mean, I'm sorry, 40th birthday with me. So it's been fun. Back when I built that car, there weren't very many women that had their own car. People said, wow, your husband let you drive this, or your boyfriend let you drive this. I said, no, this is my car. And I drove it for a few years without my interior finished. So, but I had a great group of guys that I ran with that were happy to have me with them because I knew mechanically about cars. And what I didn't know, they would help me learn. So I think it's just having that willingness to learn and not being a prima donna, whether you're a man or a woman, and say, oh, I know everything. When you have that willingness to let people help you, a lot of people will help you and invite you into this hobby. And I see more and more women who have their own cars now, and I see more and more men becoming more involved in the mechanical part of their cars, which back even when I sold cars, many men didn't understand the true mechanics of a car. They didn't know how to check their oil. They didn't know a lot about mechanics. They didn't have a father like I did or a grandpa that taught them about cars. So I think it's really come a long way, and I'm really happy to help women and men get involved in this hobby.
So Keith, we in Motor City often say the auto heritage is embedded in the culture of our region. I mean, it's something that you can't avoid given its history. And you included the auto heritage events like the Woodward Dream Cruise or Eyes on Design, and you visited Autorama, or you visited attractions like M1 Concourse and the Michigan Military Museum and stalls. So they kind of became their own characters in the film as far as the way they were presented. What were your impressions in shooting at these locations and learning more about Michigan's auto heritage through them?
You know, every time we had a chance to go film at any iconic location like Stalls and Eyes on Design. And Eyes on Design, I was drawn to, you know, we were invited to film at a lot of car shows, but I was really selective. I really wanted the car shows to have some depth of value to me as a story. And so Eyes on Design, of course, I was drawn to that because of the fact that some of the judges are blind. And I just thought that was so interesting that through tactile touch, they could feel a car and sense what they feel made the car special and unique. And ironically enough, a lot of times the judges that are blind actually select cars the other judges that could see the same winner. So it was really, really special. But I think that every time we stepped into another location, it was always an exciting time for us. I'll be honest, we were kind of like kids, you know, filming on Woodward during Woodward Dream Cruise, in the morning with 12 cars and a state police procession doing several loops. I mean, we controlled Woodward for the period of traffic in the morning for a couple hours. It was something that we'll always remember that moment. It was really special. And of course, everybody said that you would never be able to pull that off, but thanks to the Michigan State Police, we pulled it off. So I think that every location we went to, all the places we had a chance to film, you know, for us was just always exciting and fun for us. And we knew that it was an imperative part of the story, that in some way, as we stitched the story together, it was going to have a lot of meaning to the community.
Excellent. So the film premiered back in June of 2023, for those watching this in real time, or if they're watching it years later. It's already aired locally on PBS, but it's set for an encore presentation coming up. So can you tell us about when we can see the film?
The film will air again on August 17th at 9 p.m. on Detroit Public Television. They are starting to move the film throughout the whole state of Michigan and all the PBS stations. Indiana, the state of Indiana, PBS station has picked up the film. So we're starting to move the film through film festivals as well. So I think this will be a story that will reach generations. This is not a story that's just for, you know, us individuals who are older, but still very relevant, but for sure the younger generation. And you'll see that in the film. You know, we made a point of stepping into who's the next generation? Who are the next generation car builders? Who's the next generation car designers? So you see a lot of youth in this film as well. And so I think it'll have a powerful story for many years to come, as well as music. I mean, music was an important part of the story, and so we really spent time picking songs from an era that would resonate with all the individuals watching it, because that music, that the soundtrack of the music in our film is the same soundtrack of the similar music you'll hear at any car show, hot rod show, muscle car show, Autorama, et cetera, et cetera. But it also teaches the younger generation about the music that we loved, and now they'll see it through and why we loved it so much and how it was relevant to riding, driving, cruising up and down Woodward and racing cars. Sure. You know, I'd like to thank Motor City's National Heritage for supporting this film and just understanding the value of our history and how it impacts generations to come. I mean, it's organizations like this that are so important to storytellers like us to enable us to get stories told that, you know, of stories that we know that are really important and relevant, but having like-mindedness of leadership that they offer is imperative to what we do.
Thank you. Well, thank you both for sharing. It's been a good time, so appreciate it. So thanks a lot, Diane. Thanks, Keith.
Thank you.
You know, whether it's a muscle car, a hot rod, a pickup truck, no matter what it is, they all have one thing in common. They're all born in Detroit.